seems to be working. Hey, it's me. I'm Ross. And I've been realizing that I haven't done a live reading from Chick Bassist on this channel yet. And so I'm going to remedy that. Chick Bassist is the rock and roll novel, novella, whatever you want to call it, that I wrote and was published by Lazy Fascist Press back in the Stone Age, 2012. This cover is a photo by Teresa Kariakis, and bonus points if you can identify the subject of the photo in the comments. Hey, there's your rock and roll trivia. Anyway, I'm going to read this to you. I'm not sure how far I'm going to get. Dog is barking. Ellie, come here. Eleanor. Now, she may bark again. She's probably barking at birds. She does that. Chick Bassist. Track one. Drummer of the drum. Any minute now, you're going to get up off the couch. You're going to grab your keys, and you're going to head out that door. You're going to squint the sunlight, put on your shades, and start that six-block trek downtown. You're going to stop at the Smoking Monkey, the bar that used to be called Charlie's, the bar where you made out with Tish in the men's room that Halloween night after you played that kick-ass show. Christ, was that really 3 years ago? Any minute now, you're going to walk to the bar, you're going to sit down, you're going to have a beer, and when Robbie finally shows up, you're going to buy him a beer with the $10 that Aaron gave you last night. And as he drinks that beer, you're going to let Robbie know that he's now and forevermore the ex-bass player of Heroes for Goats. Hang on one second. Eleanor! Come here! That's a weird whistle. Hey! Okay. Since Eleanor wants attention, we're going to have her sit with us. All right, let's start this over. Hey, I'm going to read from Chick Bassist with a dog. Track one. Drummer of the drum. All right, let's start over. Any minute now, you're going to get up off the couch and you're going to grab your keys and you're going to head out that door. You're going to squint at the sunlight, put on your shades, and start the six-block trek downtown. You're going to stop at the Smoking Monkey, the bar that used to be called Charlie's, that bar where you made out with Tish in the men's room that Halloween night after you played that kick-ass show. Christ, was that really 3 years ago? Any minute now, you're going to walk to the bar, you're going to sit down, you're going to have a beer, and when Robbie finally shows up, you're going to buy him a beer with the $10 that Aaron gave you last night, and as he drinks that beer, you're going to let Robbie know that he is now and forevermore officially the ex-bass player of Heroes for Goats. You're going to give him the bum's rush, the boot. You're going to do this. You're going to do it because what Robbie did on Saturday night was inexcusable. You're going to do this because, like Aaron said, Robbie is unpredictable, a fuck-up, an addict, a junkie. And it's only a matter of time before he hurts someone other than himself. You're going to do this because you're the drummer. The heartbeat of the band. You're going to do this. Any minute now, you think to yourself as you watch the clock hands creep along, you could just say fuck it. Pocket Aaron's $10 and tell her Robbie never showed. You could just take another pull off the bong and stay home all day, watch cartoons or practice or read old comic books or something. You could get yourself another drink for courage, for fortitude. No, you've got to do this. You've got to be the one. You promised Aaron that you'd take care of things. You saw how he acted toward her, how he pushed her. You can do this. You can take the beating. You can sit there, drink your beer, listen to whatever lame excuses Robbie throws at you. You can just let it flow past you. You can be bulletproof. It's like your dad said after those kids in grade school pushed you into that ditch and broke your sticks. If you're going to be a drummer, some days you're going to have to be the drum. You're going to do this. You can. Do this. Any minute now. Any minute now, you're going to get up off this couch and you're going to forget about the bong on the coffee table. You're going to lace up your boots, grab your leather, and head out that door. You're going to march the six blocks to the Smoking Monkey. You're going to march past the laundromat where Tish used to buy her dime bags back before she went clean and found Jesus. You're going to march past Marduk's liquor store, past the graffiti-covered out-of-service bus stop with its shattered glass, past the old lady on 4th Street that always hits you up for spare change. You're not going to blow this off. You're going to head down to the bar, savor your beer, and let Robbie have it with both barrels. Shit. You might as well be going over to his house in the middle of the night to smother him with a pillow. He's not going to take this sitting down. He's going to freak out, yell, throw his beer across the room. He's going to take a swing at you, call you an asshole, a traitor. He's going to make a scene, and Mark behind the bar is going to have to call the cops. You could just blow this off, keep the $10, fire up the bong, and turn on the TV. You could just tell Aaron you forgot, that Robbie never showed, that the bar was closed. You could just start practicing somewhere else across town, change the name of the band, and hope that Robbie never catches on. But no, you can't do that. You gave Aaron your word. You said you'd take care of it. You're the drummer. You're the drum. You can take it. Any minute now. You're going to get up off the couch, pull on your boots, take a quick bong hit for courage, and head out into the unforgiving sunlight to accomplish this dirty deed. You're going to walk through the alley where you held Tish's long black hair out of the firing line as she puked out the ghost of too much partying. You're going to walk past the wall where she spray-painted your names entwined in a big black heart back before she found Jesus and stopped returning your calls. You're going to walk past the burned-out remains of Amsterdam's, the biker bar where the skinheads rioted last summer. You're going to stand out in front of the smoking monkey and finish your cigarette. You're going to crush that cigarette out on the sidewalk beneath the sole of your boot. You're going to go inside and order a beer, and you're going to wait for Robbie to show up. You're going to shatter Robbie's dreams, kick his dog, piss on his cornflakes. You're going to say it just like Aaron told you to. Look, Robbie, you fucked up. You need help. You're a junkie, an addict. You're unreliable. You're violent. You're out of the band. Yeah, you can do this. Any minute now, you're going to stop feeling sorry for yourself. Stop thinking about Tish. Stop dwelling on the past. You're going to take a hit off the bong that Tish gave you for your birthday 2 years ago and try to figure out where you left your boots. You're going to put on your boots, lace them up, grab your leather, your armor, and head down to the smoking monkey. You're going to meet Robbie there. And you're going to kick him out of the band. You're not going to sit at home in a stone stupor thinking about Tish and wondering how she could have left you for a dead guy. You're going to do exactly what you told Aaron you would. You're going to meet Robbie at the bar, buy him a beer, and drop the hammer. You're going to tell him that he fucked up, that he crossed the line by shoving Tish, that he's out of Heroes for Goats for good. You're going to tell him that he needs to clean up his act, that he needs to get help any minute now. You're going to walk out the door, walk down to the bar, and Robbie will be waiting there for you. You're going to buy him a beer and tell him that he's out of the band. You're going to listen to his excuses and let him bounce off your Teflon skin. After that, you're going to walk home past the apartment where you lived with Tish. Try not to think of her. You're going to walk past the Vatos working on their lowriders on 5th Street and avoid eye contact. You're going to walk past the skinheads drinking beer out of paper bags on 3rd Street. Try not to say anything stupid. You're going to kick Robbie out of the band. Walk home. Take a couple hits off the bong and watch TV. You can do it. You can take it. Any minute now. Any minute now. You're going to get up, turn off the TV, put the bong away, put on your boots, grab your leather, grab your keys, and head down to the smoking monkey. Robbie is going to meet you there. He'll already be waiting inside. You're going to give him the bad news that Aaron wants him out of the band, that he went too far when he shoved her. You're going to play him cool, buy him a beer with the $10 Aaron gave you, and let him down as easy as you can. You're going to listen to his sob stories, listen to how he's trying to kick his habit, how he deserves another chance. You're going to let him believe that Aaron is the bad guy, that she's the villain, that she's the one that wants him out of the band. You're going to do your best to avoid conflict. You're going to drink your beer. Kick Robbie out of the band and go home. You're not going to sit here on the couch all day debating whether or not you should try to call Tish. Besides, you'd probably just get one of her parents anyway. You're going to do exactly what you told Aaron you would. You're going to deal with the situation. You're going to do this because, like Aaron said, Robbie is unpredictable, a fuck-up, an addict, a junkie, and it's only a matter of time before he hurts someone other than himself. You're going to do this because you're the drummer. the heartbeat of the band. You're going to do this any minute now. Track two. Anyone can play guitar. Erin Locke, the queen of rock, wakes up at the crack of noon. La cucaracha has infested her dream and now echoes through her hotel room. What the fuck is that? Erin's voice is muffled by the thick blankets that completely cover her. Beside the lump that is Erin lies a black Ibanez bass guitar. A Heroes for Goats sticker adorns its reflective surface. Erin thrusts one arm out from beneath the blankets and fumbles for the non-existent alarm clock. She's still slogging off the fragments of her dream, that goddamn recurrent creep-out where she's a praying mantis, translucent green, perched on the crest of a burning city, devouring her still copulating prey mate. This time, her meal would warn her father's face. Those dreams were the worst. Other nights, the dream would feature Polly's face or even Lou Reed's. Those times weren't so bad. There was something magical, almost poetic, in devouring Lou Reed. One day she'd meet him, the man himself, lure him into a dark alleyway, and there she'd consume him, absorb his power. Fuck. Too quickly, her thoughts shift to Sunday. Sunday, she woke up from nightmares of Robbie, wearing her father's face. She woke up crying. This time, she was only a little bit hungover. Erin stretches as the dream dissipates, fades from view, but never quite goes away. Lunchtime, mumbles Erin. Time to rock and roll. She listens to construction noises across the street, the deaf neighbors shouting at each other, the television left on, murmuring from last night. Dracula's Daughter was on channel 23, but she fell asleep halfway through it. She groans, yawns, stretches, finds the ghetto blaster on the nightstand, her shoulder still aches. Fucking Robbie. White light, white heat, 0000. She hits play on the tape deck. Wheels squeak to life and a chopping guitar beat erupts from the speakers, drowning out the outside world and its uninvited noises. She deftly plucks a cigarette, not the lucky one, from its stiff cardboard pack and lights it as it touches her lips in a single, fluid motion. Her feet hit the floor. She draws in a lungful of smoke. The carpet crunches slightly across the street. A roach coach drives away from a construction site, and workmen start to eat egg salad sandwiches. Erin exhales. She opens her eyes. White light, white heat. The Velvet Underground's best goddamn record ever plays for the 333rd time. I can't see with your head in the way. Let's shift positions. Hey. This tape's been a part of Erin's morning ritual almost every day since the last time she saw Polly. The tape's A-side, white light, white heat, is followed by 5 minutes of silence. The B-side is live at Max's Kansas City. She's listened to the B-side exactly twice. The A-side is just too good, worth rewinding for. The tape, like everything in life, deteriorates a little bit every time she plays it. A few magnetic particles stay behind. The plastic stretches. Friction pulls at the wheels. Tiny holes appear. Dropouts. Every time Erin plays the tape or soundtrack, her memories degrade. It's still mostly dark in the room, and it takes Erin's eyes a few moments to focus. She must be getting old. Sometimes she's tempted to steal a pair of glasses from the drugstore, granny glasses, just to see if they help. Maybe rose-tinted ones. Yeah, that's it. That's all she needs. Just put on a pair of magical lenses and things will get better. More cash will come in. A killing will get more than local radio. National, maybe. Even international. She'll find a new bassist. Christian the drummer will stick around. Christian's loyal to a fault. She can stick it out, stay in town, not let Robbie get the best of her. The rosy shades would make sure of that. She could play some little acoustic things here and there in the meantime, coffee shops, libraries, busking. She wished she could just play bass herself. Maybe she could have herself cloned. That'd be easiest. Besides, she missed playing bass. She could have herself cloned twice, play drums too. Who needs a band? Heroes for Goats could be a self-sustaining organism. Eventually, she focuses. A beam of sunlight streaks through the hole in the blackout curtain, paralyzing specks of dust and purple curls of smoke in midair. On the television, a smiling cartoon airplane repeatedly smashes into a building. Deer in headlights, she yawns, stretches again, reaching toward the ceiling, cigarette perched between two fingers. Erin carefully crushes the burning coal of her half-smoked cigarette in a bedside ashtray. no sense letting it go to waste. She peels off her Motorhead t-shirt, tosses it into the corner with her other clothes, then walks to the bathroom, flipping off the TV on the way. The gift. 2 minutes, 47 seconds. The tile floor is cold as is the porcelain toilet seat. Aaron pees, listening to its rhythm against the water in the toilet bowl, hits the shower with a vengeance. She doesn't flush first. That would spoil the pressure. Hot water for only, not quite scalding. Wonderful. It's been a week since she last washed her hair, and maybe by adding a little bit of water, she can make the conditioner go far enough. It always goes twice as fast as the shampoo. In any case, she'll be able to toss the empty bottles, leave them behind, less crap to carry. As she lathers her hair, Aaron thinks about Polly. Was it a year since she'd last seen him? She'd been missing him, even before Marco at Zion Eye Records called last week. Aaron, hey, came the stranger's voice through the phone. Look, we're auditioning bass players for Polly Gray. Polly mentioned you. Listen, if you can make it up to San Francisco in the next couple of weeks, we'd love to try you out. This was serious. A real label, the big time, and playing with Polly again, even if it was just bass, man, that would be great. Sure, it's a reggae band, but she can fake it. She did just fine back in the day, playing Clash covers with Polly, and those were reggae bass lines. She'd do fine now. She thought it funny how Polly was all serious Rastaman now. She'd always thought of him as more white than black, more like his mom than his dad, suburban, picket fence, station wagon, Wonder Bread. Aaron's first band was Polly's third. Niggers of the Narcissus. Polly got the title from a book by the guy that wrote Apocalypse Now. Polly read it. She never had. He tried to explain it once or twice, but literature was lost on her. Boring. Later, after they heard that someone else had beaten them to the name, they changed it to Self-Absorbed Negro. It seemed only fitting that he'd eventually be fronting the Polly Gray Band. At first, Aaron and Polly had played punk rock cover tunes, a few originals, over a drum machine's steady beat. She'd fallen in love, her first real love. Polly was beautiful, defined without working out, cafe au lait, dreadlocked. He smelled like cinnamon and sandalwood. They'd have perfect children. He taught her bass, guitar, music theory, and how to smoke dope out of an apple. Anyone can play guitar, he'd say when she got frustrated. Most of rock and roll was just the 1-4-5, the tonic, the subdominant, the dominant. Empires have been built on the 1-4-5. It was Polly who first called her the Queen of Rock. And the fact that she turned it into the battle cry that opens up a killing gets her through the day. Sometimes. He could be so smug, so into himself, though. That's why she had to bail. Had to make it on her own. She'd grow tired of his quips, his Jimmy Page-isms. Rock and roll was creative forgery, he'd say. Steal from the best. When you fuck up and hit the wrong note, do it again. People will think you're improvising. Sure, they spent countless hours on stage or in each other's arms and watched 1,000 monster movies together. And those times were good, but he's just too self-absorbed, too into himself. As Aaron coaxes the last remnants of the conditioner from the bottle into her hand, her thoughts turn to Robbie. She broke a cardinal rule, her rule, by sleeping with him. Sure, it was after a good show, after the label people had been talking to him, and they were both pretty tanked. But she fucked up by giving in. Hey, baby, we did it, he said. That led to kissing, which led to grunting, swearing, and sweating. The beast with two backs, she'd slept with an employee, with Robbie, for cripe's sake. He wasn't anything that she could fall in love with. He did all the things a male was supposed to, but still, the connection, the fusion of souls that should accompany those oh-so-bass functions didn't happen. Robbie was just the bass player. Besides, after it happened, Robbie got weird. First, he got all possessive in public. Then, once she laid down the law with him and told him it wouldn't happen again, he became withdrawn. She figured he was sliding into old bad habits when he started showing up late for shows and fucking off. Saturday, they played a bar show, and he was drunk and violent. He shoved her into a wall. Robbie had to go. Aaron leans her head back, rinsing Robbie away with the conditioner. Aaron throws aside the curtain. Across from her stands her doppelganger, reflecting through the curling steam. Aaron flashes her teeth into a growl, thrusts her arms out to the sides. The mocking form does likewise. Not bad for 26. She turns, examining her pierced and tattooed skin, a life history, 6 years of ink, branding, memories reflected. The purple-scaled dragon with its tail curled around her right arm represents strength. The burning skull on her left shoulder, mortality. The twin captive bead rings through her nipples are a souvenir of playing in NYC. The black sun over her navel chakra keeps her emotions in check. She looks at her face. Water drips from her black hair. Minimal wrinkles, great cheekbones. It's your bone structure, contemplates Aaron. That's what makes you pretty. It's the scars that make you memorable. She grins at the mirror. Maybe she should blow off rock and roll entirely, take up creepy Mark on his offers to make her a porn star. How hard could that be? Some pictures, a few videos, and she'd be worshipped by millions. Just like rock and roll, but without all the hard parts. I'm Aaron Locke, the motherfucking queen of rock. She scowls at the mirror. I wake up at the crack of noon. She wraps her hair in a towel, steps out of the shower. Lady Godiva's operation. 11 minutes, 3 seconds. Which face today? Aaron asks the mirror as she opens up her makeup case. Gloria Holden and Dracula's daughter? Zita Johann and the mummy? Nah, for today it should just be Aaron. Eyeshadow, liner, no foundation, no rouge. Nordic cheekbones have their advantages. Nothing come hither, nothing overdone. She carefully applies her eyes, transforming herself into the rock goddess that she knows she is. She brushes out her hair, passing the brush through her raven tangles 100 times. Yesterday, Aaron gave Christian $10 to buy Robbie a ceremonial last drink and kick him out of the band. That left 36. Not enough to pay rent next week. She liked this place. It was clean. Well, clean as a hotel can get. People leave her alone, but it's unavoidable. It's time to move on. Besides, the deaf gay guys next door yell at each other all the time. Deaf people are noisy. 36 will probably get the van halfway up the state. Won't leave much for food or room or anything else, but she figures she can make it to San Francisco in a day. The van should make it. The tires aren't too bald, and she has the toolbox in the back. It's a nice thing about having a Volkswagen. You can fix most problems with spare change and bubble gum. Any problem, she can sleep in the van. She plays for tips along the way at one of the rest stops, sells a CD or two. She may be able to manage the trip in comfort. She runs through the list of people that owe her money. Zilch. Well, there's that indie record store on Main Street, but the owner will probably just offer to mail a check. That's all he ever does. Half the bands in town call him Johnny the Jew. She considers creepy Mark's offer again. $300 for some snapshots would be some quick cash, and the van could definitely handle the short hop to L.A. Aaron applies lipstick, blood red, then daubs her lips on a Kleenex. She blows a kiss to her reflection, leaves the bathroom, and gets dressed. Black jeans, black boots, black Sabbath t-shirt. The Queen of Rock is ready to face the world. Here she comes now. 15 minutes, 56 seconds. Aaron sings along with her favorite song. Now, if she ever comes now, now. She packs her things, puts her bass back into its case, gets ready. If she ever comes now, now. She leans three guitar cases holding her bass, a black Gibson SG and a Martin acoustic against the wall by the door. Nearby, she stacks two microphones along with her custom amplifier and cabinet, almost ready to go. If she ever comes now. She grabs her gear bag, her cables, her microphones, her pedals, ready, just like for a show. She throws a milk crate loaded with unused effects, tuners, a teak four-track, an old Akai drum machine on top of the speaker cabinet. She gathers up her clothes, black concert t-shirts and jeans, the few nice things hanging in the closet, thrusts them into two beat-up black suitcases. She grabs the shoebox full of cassette tapes, every song she's ever loved. She'll call Christian when she gets to where she's headed. She grabs the bag of toiletries from the bathroom, flushes the toilet. I heard her call my name. 17 minutes, 55 seconds. Now, with everything packed, Aaron sits down on the edge of the bed. The dream's residue still lingers on the walls of her brain. So many destinations, so many paths. In a minute or so, she'd load the van and head out, destination unknown. It was time to wander, time to throw caution to the wind still. There was something that she had to let out. She pulls a red spiral notebook from her gear bag. A Sharpie is clipped to its cover. She pulls the cap from the pen. inhales its acrid odor and starts to write, Dracula's daughter. Some people say, I think and drink too much, but I always try to stop before I drain the last drop. Unlike you, Daddy. I inherited it all from you, Roman nose, awkward pose, and that stare, too intense, too much. But I'm dealing with it. Unlike you, alcoholic, fucked up time bomb, waiting for the perfect moment to let shrapnel fly, piercing passers-by and me. Sometimes I can't help myself. I swear, this time different, no marks, no bruises, punctures, show restraint, don't be greedy, don't take it all. After all, I am your flesh, your blood. Yeah, that might work. Erin jams the notebook back into the bag, zips it closed, and picks it up off the bed. She makes the first of several trips to the van, bursting into sunlight with new resolve, the feedback and drums swelling from the last moments of I heard her call my name, transform into the blistering crush of Sister Ray, providing a perfect counterweight to loading the van. Sister Ray, 22 minutes, 31 seconds. The sun stings her eyes, but something about its warmth reassures her, makes her feel like everything will work out for the best. She's thinking how nice it'll be to see Polly. Once the van is loaded, Erin looks around the room one last time, making sure she isn't leaving anything behind. She pulls on her leather jacket and a pair of fingerless black gloves. As Sister Ray plays at maximum volume, Erin yanks the cord from the wall, and the ghetto blaster switches over to battery power. Time to hit the road. So that was from Chick Bassist. If you dug it, leave a comment. Throw me a like. And if I see enough, maybe I'll come back and read some more of it. Have a great day. Thanks for tuning in.